Nat King Cole was the rare artist born with a genius for playing music and for singing it.
Mona Lisa, Mona Lisa, men have named you.
It's not easy to sing the way my father was singing, which is just pretty straight out and pretty real.
The mystic smile.
I can put him on and listen to him and he soothes, you know.
He gave an abundance of love to the world, a world that would not always love him back.
The greatest thing.
With all the acclaim and adulation that he got, he was pretty cool.
He was well loved. He was really well loved.
And be loved in return.
In 1919, World War I had ended, and across America, young men were coming home, some to heartfelt adulation, others to a rude awakening that there were battles to fight on this shore. Meanwhile, in the North, young people were embracing a jazz age spirit of anything goes. Life was different in the rural South, a world known for having two faces, one lush and inviting, the other stark and indifferent. Nathaniel Adams Coles was born here in Montgomery, Alabama, March 17, 1919, the fourth child of Edward James and Perlina Coles. The Coles were poor by money standards, but they were rich in their sense of family and of faith.
Of course, his father was a minister, very respected minister, you know, kind of a very nice man.
There's nothing negative about my dad. And if you were ever around that, there was nothing negative about that. He was, you know, he walked tall and he was tall.
Reverend Coles hoped that his children would follow him into the church. They did, but it was from their mother, who played piano for the choir, that they took their cue, especially young Nat.
You know, he exuberated love. You know, my mother's nickname was Love, and he was like, you know, that's what he was.
He was very, very fond of his mother, and a lot of things that he said when he did talk a lot were things that he learned from his mother. He would talk to me about. He talked a lot about her.
During the 1920s, millions of African Americans left the South in search of opportunity in the North. The Reverend Coles was no different. In 1923, he moved his family to Chicago to take over the pastorship of the Second Progressive Baptist Church.
Finally, he said, "Dad, you said God can do anything." I said, "Yes, God can do anything, son." He said, "I bet he cannot get bare naked and sit on this red hot stove with no clothes on."
Nathaniel started playing piano at the age of 4 and was soon playing gospel numbers at church. At age 10, he won a music contest for his rendition of "Yes, We Have No Bananas." His prize, a turkey. The painfully shy Nat quickly learned that his talent as a musician could captivate audiences and gain him recognition. By the 1930s, Chicago's music scene was thriving with jazz clubs, speakeasies, and all-night jam sessions. For the teenage Nat and his brothers, all musically gifted, this world was both exciting and educational.
He was a wizard on that piano. Even at that age, he was he had a band around there while he was in school. So it was a good band.
The school was Wendell Phillips High, and the band the Rogues of Rhythm. They played for whatever they could get, including hot dogs, hamburgers, and soda pop. The point was just to play.
Nat would go down to the Grand Terrace. I know they wouldn't let him in, you know, but he'd go down and listen to Earl Hines in the door. You know, he would listen to, because he could play just about as well as Earl, I thought.
In 1935, the Rogues of Rhythm challenged Nat's hero, Earl Hines, to a battle of the bands at the Savoy Ballroom, and won. At 16, Nat's reputation was growing so much so that the great Art Tatum would come to watch him play.
He was a disciple of Art Tatum's. He loved Art Tatum and Earl Hines, but there was only one of them, so he created a style of his own.
In 1936, Nat joined his older brother Eddie's band, the Solid Swingers, and together they cut four sides for Decca's Sepia series. The year before, Eddie had dropped the S from Cole's. Nat did the same.
Well, he was like his tutor, you know. He was tell him this and do this and do that. But he was a wonderful musician.
To make ends meet, Eddie got himself and Nat jobs in the orchestra for Shuffle Along, a revival of the 1920s hit musical.
My brother Eddie was a very positive person, you know, and you know, they had their squabbles musically, but it wasn't anything, you know, great, you know. But Nat wanted to do something one way, he wanted to do something the other way, so this was when he split and got his own thing.
When it was time for Shuffle Along to tour west to California, Eddie wanted Nat to stay in Chicago with the Solid Swingers. Nat, however, had his eyes set on the road and on a dancer he had been courting in the show, Nadine Robinson. She was 27. He was 17.
Nadine was a real good woman. She was a nice woman. She and my wife were very good friends. You know, they were both dancers.
When Shuffle Along reached the West Coast in May of 1937, Nat and Nadine were man and wife. The production folded after just 3 weeks, but Nat and Nadine decided to stay in Los Angeles and make a go of it.
Los Angeles needs no prophet to foretell its greatness. This is the land of the rainbow's end.
Nat cut his teeth playing in beer joints, lucky if he made $5 a night. During the day, he jammed with musicians from L.A.'s exploding jazz scene. Nadine became the bedwinner, working as a chorus girl.
She was working at the Club Alabama. Beautiful, beautiful lady. Beautiful, just wonderful.
In September of 1937, Nat took a job at the Swanee Inn Club in Hollywood. He hired two ex-Lionel Hampton band members on bass and guitar. And for 3 months, Lee Young, brother of legendary saxophonist Lester Young, was the drummer.
It was Nat, Oscar Moore, and Wesley Prince. That was the first one. And so we worked out at the Swanee Inn, as I said, on La Brea. But I could only use a sax cymbal and a snare drum. The place was so small.
Bob Lewis, owner of the Swanee Inn, liked the new mellow sound of the trio and hired them for 7 months. One night, he presented Nat with a red crown, dubbing him King Cole.
It was great. It was just jazz, a jazz trio. That was it. I don't think Nat sang at all.
His touch on the piano was, although he played those big things like that, and he imitated Earl Hines, who was a pretty aggressive player, Nat had a soft touch even then, you know, that came out in his singing, of course.
The King Cole Trio was on the rise. By 1938, they had their own radio series on NBC, and over the next few years played throughout the country. They spent much of their time in 1941 and 42 on New York's 52nd Street, then called the Street That Never Sleeps. Downbeat magazine raved about them. In August of 1942, with the American war effort in full swing, the trio's bassist was drafted. And so was Nat, but he drew a 4F for having flat feet. New bassist in tow, the King Cole Trio was now one of the most sought-after small bands in the country. But as big as they had become, it was Nat's voice that would put them on the hit parade.
I really started out to become a jazz pianist. In the meantime, I started singing, and I sang the way I felt, and that's just the way it came out.
Legend has it that Nat became a vocalist when a customer who had had a little too much to drink yelled out for him to sing. In fact, Nat and the trio always had done the occasional vocal, though Nat's voice clearly stood out.
Hop around like a kangaroo.
By the end of 1943, The trio was such a hot ticket that they were signed by a promising new record label, Capitol.
I want frim, frim sauce with the awesome thing, with shabapa on the side.
The trio quickly scored hits with novelty songs such as Straighten Up and Fly Right and Frim Fram Sauce. As vocalist, Nat starred in promotional shorts made for film jukeboxes, popular at the time.
Five will get you 10. I'm gonna feed myself right.
The deal with Capitol went through mainly because of Nat's new manager, Carlos Gastel, a man large in size and personality, who before Nat managed the likes of Stan Kenton and Benny Carter. The music community found Nat Cole's emerging success as a vocalist surprising. They saw his real genius as a jazz pianist, as did impresario Norman Granz. When Granz organized the original Jazz at the Philharmonic concert in the summer of 1944, Nat was the first person he asked to play. Other top musicians like guitarist Les Paul were quick to follow.
And the two of us went over to the Philharmonic, and no balance, no setup, no nothing. Just take the guitar out of the case. He went over and struck the piano. We were there, boom, and we're on. You could see the audience getting more intense and more intense. I see them throwing their hats, and Nat says, I think we got something. We had something. I'll never forget it as long as I live. But we just chased it all the way out, and it just turned out once in a million years you wouldn't do it again.
Nat was so successful that Nadine no longer needed to work. She retired from the stage, hoping to have a family. Instead, she found herself alone, as Nat now traveled in a glamorous new world. By 1946, his career had reached the highest peak he could have imagined. Nat Cole was about to meet the one person who would help him climb even higher. 1946 was a very good year for Nat King Cole.
Oscar Moore guitar, Johnny Miller bass, and Nat King Cole doubling on piano and tonsils. Double groovy there, boys. Say, Nat, a lot of us in Hollywood are awfully happy and proud about your success.
Well, I ain't exactly unhappy about it myself.
If you ever plan to motor west, travel my way, take the highway, that's the best. Get your kicks on Route 66.
Route 66 was the King Cole Trio's first hit of the year. Nat also had smashes with You Call It Madness and The Christmas Song, which would become a holiday classic, but it was Nat's first number one hit that spoke to his heart.
I love you for sentimental reasons.
In May of 1946, Nat played Manhattan's Club Zanzibar, where he met a young singer also on the bill, Maria Ellington.
Well, I wasn't Cupid at the time, but if I was Cupid at the time, I'd say they were very much attracted to one another immediately. She was a very attractive woman, very well-spoken, and he was a charming guy.
I remember one night when we were being rather romantic, I should say, and we were driving along, he said, I've never met a girl like you before. And I do remember that, and later, of course, I realized what he was saying.
Maria was born in New England and raised by her aunt, Dr. Charlotte Hawkins Brown, who founded the nation's first African-American finishing school in 1902. Beautiful, polished, and socially aware, Maria displayed qualities long attributed to the talented 10th, an elite class of privileged and highly educated African Americans. Nat was smitten.
He was going on the road on some one-nighters, and he asked me, would I like to go with him? And with all my guilt, especially in those days, I said yes. And it was just, it was the night that he was to leave. And we went to the drugstore and I got a toothbrush and got on the train with him. And that's when it started.
What at first was infatuation soon became something much more serious. In 1948, after 11 years of marriage, Nat and Nadine were divorced.
The Easter wedding of Nat King Cole drew nationwide publicity, for Nat Cole was and is one of the nation's most popular singers and musicians.
The wedding of Nat and Maria was the second largest in Harlem history. The couple honeymooned in Mexico. Nat later reflected, "A honeymoon like this comes once in a lifetime." While in Mexico, they received word that an obscure song Nat had recorded a year before was storming up the charts.
There was a boy, a very strange enchanted boy.
He was approached by a fellow in a smock with a beard and long hair. I guess he was one of the original first hippies. His name was E. Nabez from Brooklyn, if I'm not mistaken.
Finally, I came to look upon nature as a great symphony and upon love as the theme of that symphony. And suddenly one day, a melody just started singing inside of me.
And that melody turned out to be Nature Boy.
Yes.
Because Abby was such a colorful character, Nature Boy made for good copy and huge sales.
And then one day, magic day, he passed my way.
The record that really built capital was Nature Boy. That sold millions, millions.
And we put him with an orchestra for the first time in his career. And he sang Nature Boy with a full orchestra behind him. And of course, the rest is history. It was a tremendous hit, and that really launched Nat as a vocalist.
Nature Boy was the perfect melding of lyric and voice, and its message that the deepest love is one that is selfless was the kind of romantic notion that white audiences could accept from a black crooner.
The greatest thing you ever learned is just to love and be loved. In return.
5 months after their marriage, Nat and Maria bought a home in Los Angeles, in affluent Hancock Park, where many of the city's white moneyed families lived.
I mean, all doctors and lawyers and, you know, all, they'd never had a African American living in that neighborhood. And so they had a meeting of all the neighborhood, which Nat attended. And this one man evidently got up and he started saying, well, da, 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 this and that. And he says, we don't want any undesirables to be living here. And Nat spoke up, I could just see it. He spoke up and says, well, I'm with you. He says, I don't want any undesirables to live here either. I thought that was great.
Vandals shot out windows, burned racial epithets in their lawn, and poisoned their dog. But the Coles refused to move. Instead, Maria set about making their new home a showplace.
She had wonderful class. She was a lady. She brought so many things into Nat's life. I'm sure a beautiful home, and she loves great furniture, and she was so elegant and wonderful, you know.
Maria also became part of Nat's professional life, advising him on his grooming, as well as career moves and finances. She later wrote, Nat Cole was an introspective man, and sometimes a little afraid of himself. He happened to need my strength.
She was a tremendous asset to him from day one, and it showed up as his career got bigger and bigger.
With Nat as the featured vocalist, the other members of his trio receded into his shadow. Oscar Moore, who had been with him from the beginning, quit the group, although he remained a friend. Johnny Miller left 6 months later, blaming Maria for the breakup.
I think he wanted to just be Nat Cole, and, you know, not the trio. He wanted, you know, see, so Oscar quit, and I think he worked with his brother for a little while, and then he quit altogether and didn't play anymore.
Well, they were used to being part of a trio, and it had become Nat King Cole and his trio, you know. I think there was bound to be some difficulty there because they were all just three guys, hail fellow, well met, you know, and friends too. But it was bound to happen.
She was doing what she felt was right for a wife to do to a husband, and that's to give him the greatest exposure and to be as successful as possible. I know that now. I didn't then.
Bongo player Jack Costanzo joined what was now Nat King Cole and his trio. With Nat's career in full swing, he and Maria began to concentrate on their family life. Nat had always wanted children, and in his marriage to Nadine, had not been able to have any. When Maria's sister Carol died in May of 1949, she left behind a little girl whom they adopted and affectionately called Cookie. 9 months later, in February of 1950, Maria would give birth to another daughter, Natalie. With a new home, a new family, and a new outlook on his career, Nat was ready to take on the world. In September of 1950, he headed overseas for a tour of Europe, where audiences unfamiliar with him were less than welcoming.
He was bombing at the Palladium in London, but not to the point. It was just, it wasn't right.
I remember this one critic, he said, this dusky man sitting over the piano and trying to be sexy. It was not a compliment. He didn't even think the music was great. And of course, Nat's music was great.
Audiences overseas had never seen a romantic crooner who looked like Nat King Cole. In time, this dusky man became the most beloved performer in the world, but not before he faced more indignities at home. In March of 1951, the Internal Revenue Service seized Nat King Cole's home. He had failed to pay $146,000 in back taxes.
He liked his home, he loved his home, and he really was very relaxed in it.
Such an occurrence was rare in affluent neighborhoods.
We've always thought it was something that had to do with some of our neighbors, some of those lawyers, etc., who lived around there. But in some way, they were gonna do anything they could to get the Coles out of there.
Nat and a band of Beverly Hills lawyers and accountants came up with a plan to save the house. Maria's aunt, originally opposed to their marriage, loaned the couple $20,000. Capitol Records, recognizing the ongoing potential of their number one star, advanced Nat $30,000 each year for the next 4 years. In return, he kept turning out hits.
Mona Lisa. Mona Lisa, men have named you.
Mona Lisa became the biggest selling song Nat King Cole ever had.
The mystic smile.
I wrote the whole melody in the car. It doesn't happen very often that way. I wrote Prima Donna, Prima Donna. It sounded awful.
Yeah,
terrible
sure
title.
Did, right.
For that Mona Lisa, strangeness in your smile.
And my brother had written Mona Lisa, so I couldn't encourage Nat too much or make too much of it. And Nat said, Mona Lisa, what is that? And absolutely refused to do it.
Your way to hide a broken heart. Many dreams.
Manager Carlos Gustell persuaded Nat to let the songwriters come to his home and perform the song for him.
Marvin Fisher was over there, and Nat told us to come in and listen to this song, and he played it, and Marvin and I looked at each other and looked back at him and said, what are you going to do an Italian song for? I remember that as clear as if it just happened. Of course, we were wrong.
Mona Lisa.
Starting with Mona Lisa, Cole produced an unprecedented string of hits, including Smile, Pretend, Tenderly, and Unforgettable.
Nat could sing anything. I don't think he minded singing commercial songs. He liked everything he did, you know. I think and actually, I guess he could use the money.
Cole chose his own material often from the deluge of songs sent him. He had the uncanny ability to look at a piece of sheet music and hear in his head the distinctive quality that would make it a hit. It was as a performer that he had to work hard at overcoming his shyness and his tendency to share the spotlight.
Carlos and I were talking to him about it. I said, why don't you just stand up and do the thing or whatever? He said, what am I going to do with my hands? And later he would say to me, you know, that's not easy, Skies. He would always say, I don't know what to do with my hands.
In 1952 and 53, Nat again changed the lineup of his trio, bringing in John Collins on guitar and Lee Young on drums. As a trio before, they were moved into the background even more as part of a large orchestra.
He wanted to be a stand-up singer. He wanted to be like Sinatra and so on and so on, you know, because he was of that stature, you know.
He was still sitting down singing until his manager, Carlos Gastel, told him that he should get up from the piano and start standing and singing. And that's when he started making the money.
Thanks largely to Nat, Capitol Records became a major player in the music industry.
When we joined Capitol and he was with Capitol, my goodness, I know we built a round building for him. So it was a good thing for all of us.
They called it the house that Nat built, you know. And when Frank Sinatra signed with Capitol, oh, we didn't need but the two.
Buddy DeSilva was head of Paramount. And Buddy said, if Nat Cole were white, he'd be bigger than Sinatra and Crosby.
Nat had succeeded in defining himself as one of the leading vocalists of the day. Still, in the studio, he remained a musician first.
Nat, you knew it would go easy, you know. All we had to do is run the thing down, make sure there were no mistakes in the band part, and man, we'd make it, bam, like that, you know.
Yeah, we're gonna make one and see what we're getting. Stand by.
Why don't you try to take a chance? Try to get a good one.
Right on the moment, he's telling us the arrangement, you know, and we're gonna record, you know, maybe in 5 minutes after that. And he was very good at that.
For the rest of Nat's life, jazz critics berated him for abandoning the piano. To Nat, his decision to sing had been purely business. Personally, he never lost his love for jazz, nor his ability to play it.
But I would tell Nat all the time, I said, Nat, you should play, you know, because most of the people here don't even know that you play. The younger generation don't even know that you play. You're a great pianist. Play. So I finally got him to play, and he cut out my solo.
Cole recorded only one more album of pure jazz, the classic After Midnight. The shy musician and reluctant vocalist had become a star. And with the civil rights era looming, the star would be reluctantly pulled into battle. Nat King Cole had spent most of the last 15 years on the road. By Easter Sunday, 1953, the stress of living out of suitcases finally caught up with him during a performance at Carnegie Hall.
When I saw him, I said, my God, you look awful. He said, well, I feel awful. I said, you should call the doctor? He said, no. I said, you got to call the doctor.
He was very, very, very ill. He had a bleeding ulcer. They called the doctor, and the doctor says, you're going to the hospital now. And Nat says, no, I'm going out there and play. And the doctor says, no, you're not. He says, because if I let you go out there and play, you're not going to finish the set. That's how ill he was.
Cole was rushed to Manhattan's Cornell Medical Center, where surgeons removed part of his stomach. Doctors ordered him to give up his 3.5 packs a day cigarette habit for 3 months. He did, for 3 months. Healthy again, Nat resumed touring. In 1954, he headed back to Europe, where 4 years earlier, he had bombed. This time, Nat received a superstar's welcome everywhere he went.
I remember in Dublin, the people were so warm. And there was a time, I wish I remembered the little hotel, and he was standing at the window. I was back in the room too, but it's so vague now, but I remember them singing to him. They were the warmest people I've ever known in my life.
Back home was another story. Too often, the color of his skin made the larger impression. Some hotels that hired him to perform refused to give him a room.
Nat was in the car, in the cab with us. And I says, well, we'll let Nat off first. And we let Nat get out. And Nat says, I don't get out here. And Nat says, well, aren't you playing here? He says, yeah, I can play here, but I can't stay here.
Privately, Cole sued many of the hotels that denied him a room, and won. He boycotted Las Vegas until 1954, when he broke the color barrier by staying in the hotel where he performed. But a 1956 incident in his home state of Alabama pushed Nat Cole's quiet approach to racism onto the front pages.
It was a sad night. The lights started coming up, just dim lights, from the pit. And I saw guys crawling on stage.
And so this one guy came to the footlights, and he grabbed Nat by one of his legs, and Nat, you know, pulled away from him.
It was bedlam. You know, women were screaming, and people were hollering, you know. So finally we got off the stage, and I never heard niggas so much in my life from the police, you know, from the police.
Cole's six attackers were arrested. In his usual courtly manner, Nat apologized to the audience for not being able to continue. His lack of public indignation was upsetting to some.
Nat, you say you don't feel bitter about what happened in Birmingham.
Well, I say I didn't feel bitter. I mean, I feel bitter personally, because naturally anyone that assault you personally, you would sort of not like that. But I didn't feel bitter against the people.
Thurgood Marshall, then chief counsel for the NAACP, suggested that the only thing Cole needed to complete his role as an Uncle Tom was a banjo. In Harlem, his records were removed from several jukeboxes. Nat was deeply hurt. One of his friends later said, I actually saw tears roll down his face.
As you know, he was vilified by some of his own people when he was attacked in Alabama because he didn't, I don't know what they expected him to do, but I think he was a little too gentle about what happened and not angry enough publicly. So, but this is the way he was. This was his character.
Some people accomplish things by jumping up and down and hollering and screaming. Well, that just wasn't his style. He was a quiet, positive type of a person.
Nat King Cole, the home state hero, never went to Alabama again. And while Nat had alienated some in the black community, his next endeavor caused white America to bristle.
The Nat King Cole Show.
The Nat King Cole Show was a network's first serious attempt to launch a TV show starring an African American. It premiered on NBC Monday, November 5th, 1956.
My greatest effort right now is this television show. In fact, that to me is a great achievement. If we can continue in this field, that is something I've looked forward to for a long time.
Everybody loved Nat so much, they donated their services free, like Peggy Lee, the Mills Brothers, Sinatra, Ella Fitzgerald, everybody.
You could see they showed the audience, and the audience was just like mesmerized and all, you know. So, you know, it made me say, man, I want to be able to do that, you know.
And I think that somehow inside that he knew that he was breaking fresh ground in a lot of ways.
Yes, it was a groundbreaker. But unfortunately, it was like they say, too early. As if that's the right thing to say.
The show got great reviews and huge ratings, but no national sponsors. White advertisers balked at having their products associated with a black man. During its 68 weeks on the air, the program found only a few regional sponsors. Nat King Cole canceled his own show, saying, "Madison Avenue is afraid of the dark."
As I've said to you before, I just get angry when I think of it. Even to this day, my husband really was hurt. He took everything personal that was done about him racially. I didn't.
As was his nature, Nat King Cole moved on. He set his sights on Hollywood, Broadway, and the world. Frank Sinatra, Bing Crosby, and Doris Day had transformed themselves from music stars to movie stars. By the mid-50s, Nat King Cole wanted to do the same.
Nat King Cole as Goldie, the fighting legionnaire.
Burn low.
But when I think about him playing parts, from Cat Ballou to being a soldier, it was Nat Cole playing Nat Cole.
Cole's one starring role was in St. Louis Blues, playing opposite Eartha Kitt. His character, W.C. Handy, often called the father of the blues, was born in Alabama, the son of a Baptist minister, just like Nat.
You're just his natural self. When it came to playing the part of Handy, I don't think he tried to act.
Cole also tried his hand at theater, mounting an unsuccessful review entitled, "I'm With You." Cole finally returned to what no one did better, singing for the world, recording songs in French, Portuguese, German, and Japanese. Nat was particularly fond of Latin America and recorded 3 hit albums in Spanish.
And he learned Spanish phonetically. He didn't know what the hell he was talking about.
Cole was now the highest paid singer in Las Vegas and the world, and his appeal didn't stop with music.
Even though he may not have been considered what the Western world thinks in terms of a handsome man, to me, he was a very handsome man.
Many women were extremely attracted to him because he had a charisma that was tremendously captured when he came on a floor.
Anytime you marry someone who is very famous, you are going to, most of the time, not all the time, but have female problems. It goes with the territory.
Though his eye wandered, Cole's focus remained on his wife and family. He had always wanted a son, and in 1959, he and Maria adopted Kelly. 2 years later, Maria gave birth to twin girls, Casey and Timon. Meanwhile, Cole continued to keep step with the times, when most ballad singers were driven off the charts by rock and roll.
Wow! Kooky, go park the car.
Cole adapted to the contemporary scene with major hits like Rambling Rose, Lazy, Hazy, Crazy Days of Summer, and Send for Me. Life was good.
Nat came in one night in the place, and he said he just wanted to play. He said, "Let's jam something, let's play." I said, "Well, man, all you have to do is get up here on the piano and start playing. Where you lead, we'll follow." That's the last time I saw him, yeah. The last time. Ooh. He left the piano smoking.
We were sitting in the back playing poker. And all at once he'd stop and he would have to get down almost on the floor and so. Just pain.
Just after Thanksgiving, 1964, Nat Cole became ill while playing the Circle Star Theater outside San Francisco. X-rays revealed a small spot on his lung. He returned to Los Angeles, where doctors found the spot was growing rapidly. On December 9th, Nat King Cole entered St. John's Hospital in Santa Monica.
When he was admitted to the hospital, he smoked his last cigarette. Never smoked. Didn't do him any good, did it?
The falling leaves.
Nat had smoked since he was 14. He always thought that the habit had improved his voice, giving it a deeper, husky, more velvet quality. Of red and gold. Nat once joked, if I ever quit, I'd be out of a job.
He first learned that he had cancer by hearing a radio report that he had cancer. And he was upset that they had put that report out. Because at that time, he thought it was a false report. And I said, Nat, I hate to tell you this, but it's a true report.
An outpouring of love came from around the world. During his illness, Cole received more mail than any other person in America.
And although he knew, he fought. He really fought. He used to go down to the church, to the chapel, I should say, every day in his wheelchair to pray.
I went to see him in the hospital, and Nat looked terrible. I mean, he was so thin. He was, if you can believe it, he was green. I mean, he was really looked terrible. And we knew that he had no hope. And it was very sad.
Nat King Cole died the morning of February 15th, 1965, of lung cancer. He was 45 years old.
Old winter song.
It was a beautiful day, the day he died. When we were driving back to the house, we passed that little man who used to sell papers on the corner. The headline said, Nat King Cole died, you know. And this little man who I'd seen there for so long, I don't know, it's just, I never forgot that. And then I really realized my husband was dead. I don't think until I went past that corner in that car that it really had hit me.
Within days, Capitol Records received orders for more than 1 million Nat King Cole albums. At his funeral, thousands of people from all classes, all races, lined the streets, hoping to catch a glimpse of the procession.
There was a boy.
He was a kind of entertainer that you felt everything he did was perfect, and his soul was in it. And he was in love with life.
Tasty. I think that's exactly the word. Anything Nat did was tasty, whether it was singing a ballad, singing a swing tune, playing the fills with his piano, or how he acted in life. Very, very tasty.
I was very proud of him and would hope to be one-tenth of the man that he was. He was quite a man.
The greatest thing.
The polish, the culture, everything that he stood for musically, I don't think will ever be gone. He left his mark.
And be loved in return. I love you for sentimental reasons. I hope you do believe me. I'll give you my heart. I love you.